Joining us now for a second hot copy, international security analyst, Dr. Andrew Kaur. Dr. Kaur, good morning. Thank you for joining us despite the late hour there in the UK.
Thank you.
Dr. Kaur, did you see this coming? I mean, a war in the middle of a pandemic, specifically in Europe at that?
Well, I mean, I've been talking about this for years. I mean, since the Crimea invasion before, it's been a danger that I think we've seen coming. And then, of course, U.S. intelligence has done a good job of predicting this, actually. They've been ahead of the game in terms of telling people that it was a false flag operation, that there was it was coming, it was very likely coming, they were in place. So I think that people have had plenty of time to see this coming over the past weeks. Markets didn't react as they probably should have leading up to it. I think they believed that it wasn't going to be as serious as it was, but in fact, it did pan out as we've been told.
Mm-hmm. But for our viewers here in the Philippines who may just be getting acquainted with this conflict, can you walk us through the root cause of this conflict? I mean, of course, you mentioned the 2014 Crimean annexation by Russia, but does it go all the way back?
Well, I think the root cause is Putin's, to put it very bluntly, Putin's a power-hungry dictator, and he wants ever more power. He has turned Russia itself into a dictatorship. He took what was a democracy and turned it into a dictatorship. And now he's trying to expand his territorial control and the control that he has over the population within Russia and outside the borders of Russia. So he's an extremely dangerous man. He's a ruthless, bloody guy. I mean, he's killed thousands and thousands of people in Chechnya and Syria with his bombing of civilian sites. The root cause, really, I mean, is the way he would explain it is he's opposing NATO expansion. So after the end of the Cold War between the U.S. and Soviet Union and NATO, the Soviet Union broke up. There were a lot of parts and pieces that resulted from that. Many of them wanted to join NATO. Many of them wanted to be democracies. Most of them wanted to be democracies because they had had enough of the Soviet Union. And many joined NATO. And at the time, a lot of Russians were not happy about that because they saw NATO as an enemy or an aggressor. It's totally false. I mean, NATO is a defense of democracy. Democracy is, self-rule. So it's never offensive. It's always defensive.
Mm-hmm. I was about to ask, how much of a threat is the NATO? Because if you're looking at the situation now, some of the criticisms are that NATO is not acting fast enough. It's not doing anything right now.
Yeah, I think that NATO has proved that it's not an aggressive alliance. If it were aggressive, it would have, at the very least, put troops into Ukraine already in order to protect that territory. It's something I actually thought we should have done, is had troops in Ukraine. I don't think, at the end of World War II, U.S. troops, French and British troops and Russian troops raced for space in Eastern Europe. And where the tanks met, that's where the Iron Curtain fell. And I think a similar situation is happening now. But instead of ourselves moving our tanks and our troops into Ukraine, Russia's taking over that space. But I think he's going to have a very, very hard time of it.
Mm-hmm. So the supposed reason for Putin authorizing this military operation, supposedly because he doesn't want Ukraine to join NATO, are you buying that?
Well, he also is, supposedly he's trying to protect the two republics in Lugansk and Donetsk, which are in the far east of the country. He is claiming that there's a genocide, which is totally false. So he's claiming that he's protecting Russian populations in these countries. He's following the same playbook as he did in Georgia, the country Georgia. He's a liar. He's cheating on multiple agreements, international agreements, the Minsk Accords, the Budapest Agreement of 1994. You know, he's just taking more territories, taking more power.
So if the goal is really just to protect the people of Lugansk and Donetsk, why is he attacking several other areas all over Ukraine? In fact, there were attacks, missiles on the capital, Kiev. There are reports that they have captured an international airport near Kiev. And the U.S. intelligence is saying that the goal is really to surround Kiev with all these Russian troops. And the attacks are coming from the north, from Belarus, from the border in the east with Russia, and even from the south. So what do you make of this?
The U.S. intelligence, actually, you're right. It says that Putin's moving in towards Kiev with lines of troops, and the goal is a decapitation of the Kiev government, basically. And that could happen very quickly. It's essentially like a blitzkrieg strategy of fast movement, which is effective in modern warfare. He's claiming that he wants to bring the Ukrainian leaders to justice for what they've done, because there's an ongoing war. He in Lugansk and Donetsk, Russia has supported rebels and who have taken these territories, and there's an ongoing war because that's sovereign territory of the Ukraine. So he blames, of course, Kiev for this. But this is all a smokescreen. What he's really trying to do is recreate the old Soviet Union. He wants to take as much of that territory as he can. Now, of course, there's a lot of NATO members now that used to be part of the Warsaw Pact or the broader, bigger Soviet sphere. And that's Poland, Latvia, Hungary, all Estonia, all the Baltic states, Lithuania. And so all of those guys are NATO members now. So if he truly tried to take those territories, he would find himself in a war with NATO, which is nuclear armed. He's nuclear armed. So what he's doing is just incredibly irresponsible during a nuclear era. Ukraine had nuclear weapons at the end of the Cold War, and they voluntarily gave up those nuclear weapons in order to, they're the only country in the world, other than I think South Africa maybe, that voluntarily gave up nuclear weapons. So, and in exchange, they got territorial security guarantees. Russia, the United States, and Britain promised in the Budapest Agreement to promise their territorial integrity, guaranteed their territorial integrity. So there's a total violation of the rights of Ukraine, first by Russia, but unfortunately, the U.S. and Britain and our allies simply have not done enough to protect Ukraine. And actually, I would argue in a similar way, we haven't done enough to protect the Philippines from what China's doing in the South China Sea. So unfortunately, we need to take a more activist stance and a tougher stand against Russia and China, because they're two peas in the same pot. They're dictators, they're allied with each other. They've recently signed a strategic agreement on February 4th, basically against NATO expansion, but they really, what they're doing is they're creating space for themselves to expand at the expense of the US and other democracies who are allied in Asia and Europe.
Mm-hmm. So I'll get to that in a bit, Dr. Kaur, but looking at the situation on the ground now, how likely is it that the Russian troops will be able to take over Kiev or surround it, as the U.S. intelligence is saying? What are the chances that the Ukrainian army or the military is able to resist a Russian invasion, considering that they are outnumbered, they're outgunned, they fail in terms of, if you just compare the metrics, in terms of the number of troops, in terms of the equipment that they have, and they're not getting help as of now from NATO or from the US?
Well, I think that they may be falling back into a guerrilla-style war against the Russians. I don't think they necessarily want to mass their troops for a frontal assault. in that case, they would be easy picking for very powerful Russian weapons. I also don't think that the Ukrainians necessarily want to hold territory in terms of their cities. Russia is a nuclear armed power. If they held their cities from Russia, Russia could potentially threaten them. Russia is already putting veiled threats, veiled nuclear threats against anyone who helps the Ukrainians. So, you know, this is something that I think is going to develop into a guerrilla warfare where the US and allies are supplying the Ukrainian insurgents, if they want to fight, which I think many of them will, with weapons such as the Javelin anti-tank missile, which is a shoulder-fired missile, or the Stinger air defense missile, which is also a shoulder-fired missile that can shoot down airplanes and helicopters. And some of them have already been shot down, according to the Ukrainian press, the Ukrainian government's press. Some of these Russian planes and helicopters have already been shot down.
Mm-hmm. But the U.S. and some European countries are already providing ammunition or firepower to the Ukrainian troops. Are these enough, though, at the moment?
Well, they're certainly better than nothing, and I think they might be enough. I mean, in addition to the weapons on the ground and the troops on the ground that Ukraine has, the U.S. and allies are putting in very, very tough economic sanctions. I think economic sanctions like we've never seen before. Russia is not going to be able to use the U.S. dollar anymore. They're not going to be able to use the pound sterling. It's going to make it very, very difficult for them to sell their oil and gas. Even with China, which is trying to promote the sale of oil and gas in the yuan or renminbi, a lot of that, most of their contracts, even with China, are in hard foreign currencies like the dollar and the euro and the pound. So what they're doing, China and Russia, is they're moving a lot of their contracts actually over into the euro, because the euro had not been threatened yet in terms of the sanctions. But I think that we're seeing very, very strong statements coming from the Europeans at this point. And I think that we might see euro-based sanctions as well as dollar and pound sterling sanctions on Russia now.
Mm-hmm. But will the sanctions work? Because, for example, if the U.S. is blocking Russian assets, Canada is canceling export assets, U.K. is freezing assets of Russians in the U.K., even those of the rich Russians, EU is freezing Russian assets in 27 EU countries. Will these sanctions actually work? The Russian government is saying it has $631 billion in reserve. So they have the money. But will that be able to last, how long this conflict might take?
Yeah, I don't really think that they're going to win. I think that Russia is going to lose this conflict. And I think they're going to lose on multiple levels. There's the economic level that is really geared towards causing pain for the elites in Russia that might be able to remove Putin from power. That's a major goal. There's also the military level. There will be, unfortunately, Russians going home in body bags, back home to mother and grandmother, who are not going to be happy and are going to put pressure. There's been calls, President Zelensky of Ukraine has called on the Russian people to rise up and resist the war. There already have been large demonstrations in Moscow and many arrests, actually, of the demonstrators. So the Russian people themselves, I think, know deep down that this is a very, very bad war and that it's not good for them. It's not good for the world. Unfortunately, they're under the thumb of this dictator named Vladimir Putin.
Mm-hmm. And what's the most likely scenario coming out of this, Dr. Kaur? Are you seeing Russia finally take over Kiev? Will they put up its own government there? Are you seeing them? You said that it might be difficult for them to reach the Baltic states, but how long will this conflict play out?
Yeah, I don't think that they're going to go for the Baltic states. That's much too much too much to bite off for them because the Baltic states are NATO. But I do think they will be able to take over the cities of Ukraine. I think they will be able to take Kiev. And I think it will be a fairly, you know, it could be a long drawn out war, like a year or even 10 years. But I think it's going to grind down Russia immensely. Russia will have to turn to China.
We apologize for that technical glitch. We go back to our discussion on the crisis in Ukraine with international security analyst Anders Kaur. So Dr. Kaur, how do you see this conflict playing out? Are you seeing Russia taking over Kiev, putting up a government there? Will he go for Baltic states? And in the meantime, what can the NATO or the UN should do about this?
Well, I think that we are likely to see Russian takeover of Kiev, actually probably Lviv too, all of Ukraine basically. But I don't think they're going to be able to control every inch of territory. The country is about the size of Afghanistan. Russia is only putting in about 190,000 troops. That's about how many we had in Afghanistan. And it just isn't enough to cover it all. So they're going to be vulnerable from guerrilla strikes from the Ukrainian forces that are probably scattering at this point to hit them where and when they deem best. I don't think Putin's going to go into the Baltic states because they're NATO states, and that would cause a much broader escalation in the war. And I think there's a lot we can do. There's more economic sanctions. I think that we're going to be cutting out Russia from most of the international financial systems, possibly even from the SWIFT interbank transfer system, which is the mother of all economic sanctions. It's never been tried before, something I've been advocating for years for Russia. And there's, you know, basically providing the Ukrainians with the weapons that they need and that are appropriate for the insurgent, what's becoming an insurgent struggle, probably against a puppet Russian government in Kiev. So I think that's how it's going to play out. I don't think that the Russian people will put up with this for long. I'm hoping that the Russian people somehow rise up against Putin and get rid of the guy and turn Russia into a democracy. That would be an ideal outcome of this. And I think we have that as an opportunity and a goal that we should be looking forward to.
And lastly, the implications on this, particularly on the Pacific, is this going to be a precedent for China potentially taking over Taiwan? Are those concerns valid?
I think it's definitely valid. I think there has been a danger that as Europe and the United States get sucked into a war in Eastern Europe, that they will lose power and steam for containing China in Asia. At that point, China may see an opportunity to try to take Taiwan or even do more things in the West Philippine Sea in terms of controlling it even more than they already do.
Mm-hmm. All right, we'll have to leave it at that. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Dr. Anders Kaur.
Thank you very much.